presentation of Fox Sports.
We are Black Hawk. We are the Lion.
Wrap up this very short two-game series. Reds trying to bounce back after a loss last night with a victory here on this Wednesday afternoon. The Reds and the A's here on Fox Sports Ohio. And hi, and a pleasant good afternoon, and welcome to Reds Baseball. Jim Kelch along with Chris Welsh. We're at O.co Coliseum. Afternoon baseball, the second game, last game of this series. The Reds had a tough one last night, took a loss by the final score of 7-3. But, Chris, it wasn't because they didn't have some pretty good opportunities in the game.
Well, they did have a lot of opportunities last night. Dusty Baker said today, hey, we out-hit them last night. But when you leave 11 men on base, you go 1-for-5 with runners in scoring position, 0-for-4. When it counted with two outs on the board, you know, that's just not going to get it done. You've got to convert when you have the chances, and Dusty Baker hopes his team has a little more timely hitting today.
Now, two players that did convert when given the opportunity last night. One was Derek Robinson.
Derek Robinson made a first batter, first at-bat out, and then they could not get him out from there. Four base hits in a row, including a bunt, a little squibber down the right field line for a double, 4-for-5. He raised his average over the 300 mark now, so Derek Robinson is rolling along. And how about Cesar Esturiz, a switch hitter down the bottom of the lineup? He got three hits last night, including a double, came around and scored a run. He also raised his average. He's nearly to the Mendoza line.
Now, pitching matchup in this game, a couple of right-handers. We'll have Homer Bailey on the mound for Cincinnati and A.J. Griffin for the Athletics.
Well, A.J. Griffin and Homer Bailey, both young right-handers. They throw maybe a little different. Homer Bailey throws about 95 miles an hour. He's relied on his split-finger fastball this year for a lot of strikeouts. His strikeouts are up. His home run rate is down. And he's a guy that really ought to be able to handle the Athletics, you would think, based on his stuff. Now, on the other hand, A.J. Griffin is a young man who doesn't throw nearly as hard as Homer Bailey, but he's a pretty good control pitcher. He's got a really good curveball. Look for that 12-6 curve this afternoon as he faces the Reds.
Well, we'll see what the Reds can do today. They lost 2 out of 3 in Phoenix. They've lost the first game here, so this road trip has not gotten off to a great start. After today, another off day tomorrow, and then 3 with the Texas Rangers. Final game of this two-game series. The Reds try to bounce back here in the Bay Area. Brought to you by the Ford F-Series trucks, the best-selling truck in America, 36 straight years. By Cincinnati USA Regional Tourism Network. Book your stay at CincinnatiUSA.com. And by Skyline Chili. Feeling good? It's Skyline time. Today's Reds-Oakland Athletics game on Fox Sports Ohio, presented to you by Kia. Oakland Alameda Conda Stadium, that's what this facility was called when it opened years and years ago. It's now called O.co Coliseum. Pretty good gathering here on this Wednesday afternoon as we take a look at Dusty Baker's starting lineup for this, the 79th game of the 2013 championship season. Chu, Robinson, and Votto at the top. Bruce Frazier, Paul in the middle. Cozart, Mesoraco is Turris. The bottom three with a DH in this game for the Reds being Xavier Paul against his right-hander, A.J. Griffin.
Well, that would be Arthur Joseph Griffin from El Cajon, California, suburb of San Diego. He is 5-6 on the year. He's had 15 starts, 8 of those quality starts. He's had a hard time finding a win over the last 5 or 6 ball games, though. He's a big guy, 6 feet 5 inches tall, 230 pounds, although he doesn't throw as hard as you think that body would allow him to throw.
He'll get us started this afternoon with a first pitch down and in to Shin-Shu Chu. Game time temperature here, 77 degrees here at O.co Coliseum in Oakland as Chu takes another errant one. It's 2 balls and no strikes. Starts the game at 271. 11 home runs. He's driven in 25. Hitless in the game last night, 0 for 3, but did drive in a run with a sac fly in the fifth inning.
Now, one thing he has done is figured out how to get on base via the base on balls, and he's already worked the count 3-0. There it is.
There is his 54th walk of the year, second in the National League, only to his teammate Joey Votto. Take a look at the Athletics defensively behind this 25-year-old A.J. Griffin. Brought to you by your Ford dealers. Cespedes, Young in center in this game, Reddick out in right. Donaldson, Lowry, Sogard, and Moss, third to first. The battery of A.J. Griffin. And for the second consecutive game, Stephen Vogt behind the plate. Here's Derek Robinson. He earns himself another start today.
Yeah, that would be against a right-hander. Of course, you've got Xavier Paul also in the ballgame. Paul today will be doing the DHing. So Xavier will be on the bench except to swing the bat, and Derek Robinson in the outfield playing defense. They think he's going to bunt. Josh Donaldson really close to third.
Yeah. Robinson, you mentioned in the open, Chris, raised his average from 273 to 301 with that four-hit performance last night.
Really amazing how a real good game can help a player immensely. I mean, here's a guy with close to 100 plate appearances.
Finds himself now in the hole, 1 ball and 2 strikes. Robinson had 3 singles and a double last night, 2 infield hits. They'll get an out at second base on Chu. A little bit of a wide throw there by Moss to Lowry. Play goes 3-6.
I'm not so sure they're going to get Derek Robinson anyway. The guy can really run down the line, and you see this is always a much tougher throw for a right-handed throwing first baseman. He creates a throwing lane, but just kind of pulls the throw, and they're going to be selling for one. So the trade-off, at least from speed standpoint for the Reds, better now with Robinson at first.
That's a play we see Joey Votto make almost like a left-hander.
Yeah, you got to get rid of the ball quickly, especially if you've got a speedy runner.
Speaking of, here is Votto. He homered last night to get the Reds on the board in the fourth inning. Unfortunately, they were already trailing at that point, 6-0. It was his 14th home run of the year. Hitting 325, fifth best in the league entering today. Driven in 38. Now 5-for-14 with a pair of home runs on this road trip, a road trip that has not started out overly well. 8-game trip. All of the teams involved in the trip. The Diamondbacks, the Athletics, the Rangers. Above 500. Reds lost two out of three against the D-backs. Lost the first game here. Combination of that Oakland win here last night and the Texas loss means the Rangers and the Athletics now are in a virtual tie for the top spot in the AL West. Texas winning percentage 571, Oakland 570.
Well, you figure that you would come in here and play the Athletics at the right time. After all, they've lost four of the last six ball games, seven of the last 11. But against National League foes, they've been really good. They look for today when they look for their fifth consecutive win against a National League team. They have won 15 of their last 20 interleague ball games and at this ballpark 18 of their last 24. So they're very formidable right here in the O.O Coliseum.
Bob Melvin, the manager of the Athletics. Former Seattle skipper, former Arizona manager. Robinson is going on ball four on a 3-2 pitch to Joey Votto. So the top two players in terms of drawing walks in the National League each draw a walk here in the first inning from Griffin.
Fourth position, right fielder, number 32, Dave Bruce.
Votto, who leads Nash at major leaguers in road on base percentage, look at that, at 489, is aboard. Two walks here in the first inning for AJ Griffin. Is that playable for votes? It is not.
Boy, I mean, just on the other side of that screen, so Jay Bruce has another life. This is one of those rare times when Dusty Baker will have back-to-back left-handers in the lineup. Of course, the Reds are missing Brandon Phillips. He's out of this two-game series. He'll join the ball club in Dallas for that game, so that's three-game series over the weekend against the Rangers, hopefully. So you got Votto and Bruce back-to-back. Dusty normally likes to separate them, lefty-righty, lefty-righty, so that you don't play it in the hand of a left-handed specialist somewhere down the road in the ballgame.
He used Frazier in the cleanup spot last night against the lefty Malone. He uses Bruce in the four hole today against the righty Griffin.
You know, as hot as Jay Bruce has been, one thing he is a glaring shortcoming this year is what he's done against American League teams. He is 4-for-32 with no homers against American League teams this year. Of course, the only other American League team the Reds have played have been the Cleveland Indians.
He strikes out there on a 1-2 pitch, a big, big out. Something the Reds on this road trip have really struggled with, and that is runners in scoring position.
The best swing he had in the at bat was the pop up that he had just fouled behind home plate. Here's a little running fastball or changeup, that is, that E.J. Griffin sells as a fastball, and Jay Bruce waiting on it but does not get it.
Reds were 3-for-30 with runners in scoring position in the three-game series against the D-backs. 1-for-5 last night. Now the runners are going. High throw to third. Double steal executed by the Reds with Robinson getting third and Votto to second base.
Well, you only do that with two outs if you are 100% certain that you're going to go, and there's nobody holding Derek Robinson on. And you can see how tricky that play is anyway, because you've got the third baseman converging at the bag with the runner, the throw coming down the line at the same time. Oftentimes you'll see the catcher throw that ball over the third baseman's head and you end up scoring a run.
And in the back of his mind, that's what Dusty Baker was hoping for.
Yeah.
Almost got it. Trying to get a win here in the Bay Area for his club. He'll be back with the Giants later in July. That ball is going to get out of play. Frazier this year, runners in scoring position with two out, hitting just 200. Look at the Reds as a team under that at 186. Oakland not much better at 216. Frazier trying to come up with something here. Second and third, two out. Strike three call. Three big chances went by the wayside last night for the Reds, and one goes by the wayside here at the top of the first. What happened in the top of the first inning? A.J. Griffin got into, then out of trouble. Bob, of course, was the bench coach with the Arizona Diamondbacks when they won the World Series back in 2001 under Bob Brenly. Here's the lineup card that he puts out there today. Chris Young, the former D-back, leads it off. Seth Smith and Jed Lowry. Then Cespedes, Moss, and Donaldson. The bottom three include Josh Reddick, Stephen Vogt, and Eric Sogard. Homer Bailey on the mound.
Well, that would be David DeWitt, Homer Bailey. We know him only as Homer. 16th start of the year. He's got one complete ball game. Coming off an outing his last time out against the Pittsburgh Pirates. Six innings of two-run baseball. And he thought that was a bad outing because he only had one pitch working for him that day. Did not have his splitter. Didn't really have his breaking ball working. And it used to be that when Homer Bailey had a bad outing, he would last three innings and give up six runs. Now a bad outing, he goes six innings and gives up two or three runs.
Yeah, just a pure numbers look at that last outing, you think, wow, he pitched well. No walks, eight strikeouts.
Yeah, don't ask him that, though. He was not all that satisfied, although he pitched well. The Reds ended up losing that game 5-3.
That was a wrap-up of the homestand against the Pirates prior to heading out to Arizona. Chris Young leading it off.
Reds are going for a sweep in that series. Were they not?
They're trying to win three out of four.
Win three out of four is a four-game series. That's right.
Yeah. 192 are the numbers for Chris Young with seven home runs, 27 RBIs. This former everyday center fielder with the Arizona Diamondbacks, they acquired him with the understanding, at least on their part, that he really was not going to be an everyday guy over here.
Well, they don't have a lot of everyday guys. They have a platoon system over here, and it worked pretty well last night against Bronson Arroyo. Now, against a tough right-hander like Arroyo, Chris Young sat out. Bob Melvin and the entire A's front office really buys into the theory of, hey, if you can't afford a bunch of really high-priced superstar players, get role players. Get guys who are good in certain specific areas, which is oftentimes a platoon player.
He was involved in that three-team deal, Oakland, Miami, and Arizona. Young comes over here. Been a couple of weeks in May. It's back most of the month of May on the DL with a strained left quad. He had some big power years in his stay with the Diamondbacks. And he's a strikeout victim to get the Oakland first inning going.
Good to see early on Homer's got the off-speed pitch working, and his main off-speed pitch is that split-finger fastball. It'll come in 86, 87, 88 miles an hour. There it is right there. Second time in this at-bat, he's thrown it up in the zone. And Young just trying to make contact right there. Comes up empty.
Well, this 27-year-old native of LaGrange, Texas, now will get Seth Smith. Hitting 283, six home runs, he's driven in 30. Smith last night had an RBI single in the fourth inning, extending his current hitting streak to 8 games. A hit today would equal his career best at 9. He's done a heck of a job against Bailey in his career. Seth Smith, 6-for-11. With 3 home runs against Homer. Two and one. He has been their most used DH this year, Seth Smith. Shifting on the infield to pull, the outfield shaded to go the other way. Way off the line at third, you see his Frazier in the hole. On the right side is his Turris. You can see Chu shaded toward left center. This Oakland ball club, much like the Reds, a very good team at home. Their victory here last night gives them a mark of 23 wins, 12 losses here at O.co. Most wins in the American League at home. Detroit has 26. The Indians and the Red Sox have 24. Votto moving to his left makes the play on that ball. Steps in the bag. Smith retired. Take a look at the Reds defensively. Brought to you by your local Ford dealers. Robinson, Chu, and Bruce in the outfield. Kozak, Frazier left side, his Turris, Votto right side. Homer Bailey caught today by Devin Mesoraco. This is something a little bit different that we don't see very often.
Now, I think the whole plan, the grand plan by Dusty Baker is to have Ryan Hannigan catch 3 pitchers, one of those being Homer Bailey, and then the other two, Latos and Mike Leake, being caught by Mesoraco. But as it turned out in last night's ball game, I think that Hannigan rolled his ankle a little bit, and it gave him some problems today when he got to the ballpark. So Dusty Baker decided to run Mesoraco out there with a rare matchup with Bailey.
In fact, only the third time this year that it has happened. Very early going, he caught him twice. The last time being on April the 21st. The last time these two hooked up in a starting role. Well, Devin Mesoraco, Homer Bailey.
Used to be the Mesoraco would catch him all the time last year, and then Bailey's numbers significantly improved.
His Turris couldn't quite get to that ball, and a 2-out single for Jed Lowry extends his hitting streak to 6 in a row.
Yeah, they improved when Ryan Hannigan got behind the plate, maybe handled Homer Bailey just slightly differently. Lowry, a little breaking ball. He's a good hitter, number 3 in the lineup. Tonight you've got some power to deal with Cespedes.
Yoenis Cespedes bats with a runner aboard and 2 men out. Watch this Oakland club in terms of stolen bases. Picked up 1 last night at 41 on the year. They're not amongst the leaders in the league in steals, but they do have, coming into this series, what, 18 or so more than the Reds. Isn't saying a whole lot, being as the Reds really don't run much at all. Cespedes takes a strike. 1-for-4 last night, an RBI single in that 4-run third. Average is way down this year, 225, compared to the 292 he posted a year ago. He has 15 homers. He's driven in 41. Dusty Baker was praising the way he played that ball off the wall last night on Frazier's ball.
Hey, he got it back in the infield pronto. He's got a very good arm, plays nice defense. They like his power numbers, but if you watch him hit, look how he points the barrel of the bat towards the pitcher. I mean, that barrel will end up in this angle right there, and it really makes the his swing arc really long to try to get to the baseball.
He gets it in the air. The left center, Robinson and Chu converge, and it is Robinson who makes the catch. Cespedes retired, and the bottom of the first comes to a close here in Oakland. Is the best of the American League take on the best of the National League. Don't miss this action coming up on Tuesday, July the 16th at Citi Field in New York. It's at 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific on Fox. Remember, you can vote for Reds players through July the 4th at Reds.com. Votto, Phillips leading their respective positions. Chu is in the top 10 in outfielders. Surprisingly, Jay Bruce is not as high as you think he would be. Doesn't mean he can't be on the team. There could be a number of Reds players. Votto and Phillips possibly as starters. Chu or Bruce possibly get there as outfielders. This team still has, in my mind, a couple of pitchers that could get there. Certainly Mike Leake has been pitching the best numbers wise. Matt Latos, Johnny Cueto. Cueto may not have enough starts. We'll have to wait and see. Reds could be well represented in the All-Star game. Xavier Paul leads things off here at the top of the second. And he's a strikeout victim. He's been really having a tough go as of late. He's now one for his last 18. And in the month of June, Paul hitting .213.
Now, there's a little deception going on there today with A.J. Griffin. He's a guy that, as I mentioned, really does not throw all that hard, at least according to the radar gun, but he records a lot of strikeouts. He's sneaky fast.
How do you get to be sneaky fast?
Well, I think you get closer to home plate. You release the ball a little bit quicker, and you don't look like you're throwing as hard as you are.
Donaldson moved back a half step on that ball, went up his glove and bounced away to the shortstop spot, and Cozart is aboard with one out.
Well, he's playing in at the edge of the grass, and it kicks out of a short hop on him, and he still gets off to the side. I mean, I don't know whether that ball bounced toward second base or whether he was going to play it off of his glove side a little bit. And when the ball comes up on you, I think the whole idea of third base, at least the old-fashioned way of third base, is that you knock it off your chest, you pick it up, and you throw the runner out. But when you play it off to the side, that doesn't happen very often.
Seventh error by Donaldson this year. Let's see if the Reds can capitalize. Runner on with one out for Devin Mesoraco. Hitting 242 with three homers, 17 driven in. Did not see action in the game last night. Last played when he started on Sunday against the D-backs, going 0-3. Long flowing gold locks of A.J. Griffin. El Cajon, California, Chris mentioned, is where he grew up. Played collegially at the University of San Diego and is noted as a free spirit, a surfer dude, right?
Kind of like the way they described you back in the college days.
Well, A, I'm not from California.
Well, you don't have to be. You got that surfer dude kind of feel about you, you know, even though you're from the Midwest.
I don't know that I could be any further away from the surfer dude aura.
I don't know. The West Coast here has had a major effect on you the last couple of days.
It made me ill. Riding the BART has really changed my life. Popped up. Sogard for the second out. The batter will be Cesar Isturiz. First multi-hit game of the year last night for Isturiz. He went 3-for-4. Another guy that raised his average a bunch from 162 to 194. He and Robinson, they had 7 of the 10 Reds hits last night. Second straight start for the veteran at second base with Brandon Phillips away on paternity leave.
Yeah, talking a little bit to Cesar before the ball game today and, you know, congratulating him on his 3 hits last night. He said he's like, well, it's about time. I mean, he's not happy that he got 3 hits. He's expecting to do better. He doesn't feel like at this point offensively he's been contributing very much. Of course, when you play behind Brandon Phillips, you're not going to get too many opportunities to play. Brandon missed 4 games earlier this year when he got beamed on the arm by the in that Pittsburgh series in Pittsburgh. But Hanahan filled in a couple of games of those absence for Brandon.
Turning on this ball is Turris into the right field corner near the wall and jumping up right at the 330 mark is Josh Reddick to take a potential extra base hit away from his Turris and retire the Reds second baseman. Nice play by Reddick as we go to commercial break. every NBA team in anticipation of Thursday's draft. Check out what Ohio professional athlete is in big trouble in today's Ohio Sports Buzz section. Plus, Game Connect has the best stats and social media for every Reds game. FoxSportsOhio.com has complete coverage from all of today's action involving Ohio sports, brought to you by, as always, 1-800-SAFE-AUTO. Drive safe, spend less. Bailey goes to work on Brandon Moss, first baseman of the Athletics. At 238 with 14 long ones, 39 RBIs for Moss. He had a hit last night. 1-for-2, a double, drove in a run with a sacrifice fly. 14 home runs on the year for Moss, but 12 of them here in this ballpark. 12 of them against right-handed pitching. And foul ground, long run for Frazier, and he got there.
Well, you mentioned a couple of times last night on foul balls that were caught by infielders in foul territory, that ball would have been 10 rows deep at Great American Ballpark. And there's no question right here. Frazier runs, looks down, runs again, looks down. I mean, like Dusty Baker said, you know, you think you're going to run into the fence, and then you look down and you realize you're another 10 yards away. So a lot of foul territory. In fact, he's probably talking about that down to the third base umpire, Laz Diaz, saying, hey, I can't believe how much foul territory is here.
People talk a lot about Great American Ballpark home runs. Well, out here you can talk about O.Co. Coliseum outs. That was one of them. Here's the third baseman, Josh Donaldson. Multi-hit game last night, 2-for-4, including that two-run homer. His 11th of the year, he's driven in team best 48. Swinging a hot bat as of late, 333 over his last 9 games. Cozart will throw him out here, out number 2. So Homer Bailey in a position to have a 1-2-3 second inning. A different year for Homer on the road this year as compared to a year ago. Last year he won 9 games on the road with a 2-3 ERA. This year he's 2-4 away from home with a 4.2 earned run average. Big difference.
Well, Homer is simply a better pitcher. He was a better pitcher last year than he was the year before. He came into camp this year even stronger than ever. And with the mindset that he wanted to fill out that role that he has always been projected to be, which is a number one starter. Not quite there yet, at least not according to the numbers.
To the right of his Torres, who can't get to that ball. Base hit for Josh Reddick. Reddick, like Lowry, extends a hitting streak. Both now sitting at 6 games in a row and a 2-out base run.
Boat's still looking for one, isn't he?
He's 0-for-3 last night. 0-for-25 with Tampa Bay a year ago. So, yes, still in search.
19 major league games. He did drive in his first major league run, batted in last night.
Good note there. Second longest hitting hitless streak to start a career since 1990. He'd get his first major league RBI last night, a sac fly in the second inning.
He wins the Nick Massett lookalike contest, though.
Yeah, you were mentioning that last night. He, in effect, is taking the place in the lineup of John Jaso, who is not on the DL but has a left palm abrasion from sliding. And it really hurts him when he swings the bat. Little floater out to right as Turris chases, and he got there. It's a vote in a bid for major league hit number one. Denied by the veteran, Cesar is Turris, putting an end to the bottom of the second. Elk, serious lawyers for serious injuries, call 1-800-ELK-OHIO. Talking earlier about how well the Athletics have played at home this year, 23 wins. But what those numbers since May the 17th, eye-popping. 13-2, a sub-2 ERA, opponent batting average right near 2. Pretty good work by the Athletics. Gave it to the Reds here last night. 7-3. Reds trying to get out of town with a win here today. First pitch swinging Chu. Long way out there to get it is the shortstop Lowry. So one pitch, one out here in the top of the third. A's, like the Reds, will enjoy another day off tomorrow. We're talking about the call-up of Stephen Vogt from their AAA club at Sacramento. They felt like they did not need a fifth starter until early July because of the off days that they have. So they called up Vogt for an extra bat. Sent down a pitcher, Straley, who is their fifth starter, to keep working at AAA Sacramento. So now, in effect, have three catchers on the roster. Jaso, who really is incapable right now of swinging because of the sore hand. Their other catcher, Derek Norris, who some feel should be an everyday guy, plays basically against left-handers. Now it's Vogt playing against the righties. Into center, Young runs it down. Robinson is gone, two out. The batter will be Joey Votto.
Now batting, number 19.
A.J. Griffin grew up a big Trevor Hoffman fan. Going to college out at the University of San Diego, watching Hoffman play. I think it was Hoffman. Yeah, it was Hoffman in Cincinnati a number of years ago who saved his 600th game against the Reds at GABP. You remember that?
I do.
At that time, he was the all-time saves leader. Out to left field and a play out there for Cespedes. And so the Reds go in order here in the top of the third against A.J. Griffin. Toyota. See your Toyota dealer or visit buyatoyota.com. Toyota, let's go places. And by the JTM Food Group, let's create great dishes together. Much better look today at the Golden Gate than we had the other day. No fog around. Really a breathtaking view. Ride your bike. You can rent a bike. Ride a bike across the Golden Gate. You can walk across the Golden Gate and back as Marty Brenneman did the other day. Well, you can ride in your car as we did. Bailey to work here in the bottom of the third. He'll get the number nine hitter, Eric Sogard. Second baseman to lead things off. Hitless last night, 0 for 2 with a walk. Starts the game at 269. To his left, Votto. Nice play by Joy. And Sogard retired to start inning number three. Batter will be Chris Young. One of the rare right-handers in the lineup against Homer Bailey. That's another area that has been very noticeable this year in terms of Homer Bailey on the improved side. Last year, right-handers hit 265 against him. This year, right-handers are hitting only 194 against Homer Bailey, and he has not given up a home run ball to a right-hander. Last year, he gave up 18 to right-handers. Look at that breakdown.
Well, the slider helps certainly that, and then adding to the fastball, he averaged last year about a mile and a half slower with his fastball than he is this year. I mean, he's getting that ball up there in the eighth and seventh and eighth inning around 95, sometimes 96. So he's bigger, stronger. I mean, he's really the man version of what the Reds drafted when they got him in the first round out of LaGrange, Texas. High school kid, long time ago. It's been kind of a long, slow process for Homer Bailey, maybe a little slower than people thought. He's now 27 years old, but as a 27-year-old, he makes his 127th start as a major leaguer.
And he gets Young looking there, so he has two strikeouts in this game. Both have been Chris Young.
That might be his best fastball of the day right here, registered 97 on the radar gun at the ballpark. Same with our Fox tracks. And even if Chris Young blinks right there, he's going to be too late to get the bat on that one.
Well, for the third consecutive inning, Bailey retires the first two and looks for the 1-2-3 frame. He has Seth Smith up there.
Really different outing today for Homer Bailey. And we told you about what he did last time against the Pirates. Six innings, only gave up two runs, but he really thought that he was a one pitch pitcher. Couldn't get the other stuff over. But today, that pitch right there, the splitter, or maybe the slider, he's hard to charge because that slider and splitter both go straight down. But his curveball seems to be working. He's throwing his fastball at 97. I would say he's got all the tools going out today.
They gave up a first inning two out single to Lowry, a second inning two out single to Reddick. Now he faces Seth Smith, grounded out to Votto his first time. Got ahead 0-2. Now he's at 2-2. This Reds team off day tomorrow down in Dallas, and they'll be ready to take on the Texas Rangers over the weekend, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I would assume, and I only assume this because of how athletically inclined you are, that tomorrow means golf.
Indeed it does.
See?
In the hot Texas sun.
Strike three called. Nasty, that's for sure. Breaking ball from Bailey there. And a 1-2-3, bottom of the third. of the game. Jay Bruce, who leads things off here, one of three players right now in the big leagues with 20 doubles, 15 homers, and 50 RBIs. Who are the other two? One of three major league players right now with 20 doubles, 15 homers, 50 RBIs. Who are the other two? Jay hitless in the game last night. Struck out in the first inning here today. Eighteen long ones, 55 runs batted in for Bruce. Tied for fifth in the league in homers. Sole possession of fifth and runs batted in. Frazier and Paul to follow. Reds have yet to have a hit. Two walks given to them by Griffin in the first. Didn't capitalize. Fielding error by Josh Donaldson at third with one out in the second. Allowing Cozart to reach, he stayed put. Down an order in the third. And Bruce strikes out for the second time. He is made quick work of there by A.J. Griffin. Don't forget, coming up later in today's broadcast, we'll have our Miller Time moment of the game, brought to you by Miller Lite. Four strikeouts now for A.J. Griffin, who has shown no signs of walking anyone else after walking those two batters in the first. Frazier got under it and pops it up. Brandon Moss right at the cut of the grass at first base makes the play. Quickly two out. Seven in a row now, retired by Griffin. Sense the error by Donaldson.
Yeah, the more you watch these two pitchers work, the more you realize that it may take just one bad pitch and a good swing to make the separation in this ballgame. I mean, they are just cutting through each other's orders. Like, they've invented new pitching.
First pitch swinging here, Paul pops it foul, and wow, look at that. Donaldson battling the sun, lost the ball. Playable baseball over there.
Well, you know, one of the problems with Donaldson is he's got sunglasses on, but they're on top of his bill of his cap. I know you get style points for wearing those, but I mean, on top of the cap doesn't help you actually see the ball when you look into the sun.
And now, Chris, particularly after he lost that ball in the sun, why wouldn't he put the glasses on? Or wear the flip downs? They're still on the head, even though he is making his pitcher work harder because he lost the ball in the sun. So then why bother to have him on the hat in the first place? Doesn't make any sense. Paul hits it hard to right, but in this big ballpark, drifting back is Josh Reddick to handle it. Back-to-back 1-2-3 innings by Griffin, who's now set down 8 in a row. course, for live baseball everywhere you go. Available for iPhone, iPad, Android, and BlackBerry 10. At-Bat delivers Reds baseball with live audio, pitch tracking, stats, news, highlights, and much more. Text At-Bat to 31826 or visit Reds.com for all the details. Homer Bailey has retired four in a row. Seven of the last eight, and a 1-2-3 third as he gets Jed Lowry. Switch hitting shortstop to lead things off. Lowry, a base hit back in the first inning. Gives him 87 hits on the year. That is already for him, hard to believe, but already a career high. Here we are, not quite to the midway point of the season. Shoots this ball into left center. That's down for a hit. Robinson over to cut it off. And Lowry is aboard with a leadoff single here in the bottom of the fourth.
Yeah, the first time the A's have gotten anything going here with a leadoff man on base. Lowry just takes that little splitter that Homer Bailey leaves up in the zone. That pitch is much better, obviously, down. When it starts at the knees and then breaks down out of the strike zone, and Lowry puts a pretty good swing on it.
So he's on for their big power man, Yoenis Cespedes. Light out to left to end the first inning. One hit in the game last night. Bailey misses outside, ball one. Cespedes last year finished second to Mike Trout of the Angels, rookie of the year voting in the American League. 23 homers, 82 runs batted in last year. Some time on the disabled list this year for Oakland with a left hand injury. Used him as a DH some earlier this year. He didn't like that idea very much. Told Bob Melvin he'd rather play the field. Put him back out of the left field. Now he's at one ball and two strikes. Bailey making only his second career start against Oakland. Both have come in this ballpark. You may remember that first one, memorable in that number one. It was his first ever road start in his major league career. Foul ball. The second thing was he pitched very well in that game. That was back on June the 19th, 2007. Picked up a win and a 5-2 victory. There are the numbers of that one. One run, two hits, seven innings. First career road start, a very good one for Homer Bailey some 6 years ago. Only his third ever career start that day. Hits here in the bottom of the fourth to get this inning started for Bob Melvin's club.
Now Cespedes rolls over a little bit on this ball right here, but he finds that hole. You got the shortstop shading a little bit towards the bag, and it opens up that hole a little bit over there, and live by the ground ball, die by it. And that's one thing that Homer Bailey's seen this year is that in increase in the number of ground balls he gets. It's been made him a better pitcher overall, but that one cost him a base hit.
Here's Brandon Moss. Two on, nobody out. Moss has hit into two double plays this year. With the benefit, a benefactor of all that foul ground here at this ballpark. His first time when Frazier went all the way over near that tarpaulin roll you see there at the left of the screen, caught his foul ball. He gets ahead, two strikes. Big difference this year, numbers wise, with Homer Bailey. ERA, first three innings, ERA, middle three innings. As we play into the fourth here this afternoon. 2-6 in the first through the third. 5.85 ERA, fourth through the sixth, 2013. From 0-2 to 2-2. Brian Price watches intently from the Reds dugout, first base side. Hard into right field. Bruce going back. That ball is over his head. Short hops the wall. Here comes the runners around. One runner around. Play to the plate. Throw is wide. Missed the base. Goes back to tag is Mesoraco. And the ball came out of his glove. And it's safe at the plate is Jed Lowry. He missed the dish going by. Mesoraco went diving for him. The ball came free.
Now that was an odd looking play, especially from our perspective. The ball comes off the right field wall and Jay Bruce just plays it great. He gets it right back into the infield immediately. And the third base coach Mike Gallego's got two runners about 5 feet apart. The first one ends up coming on in there and Jed Lowry, he misses the plate. But in the process of pursuing the runner, Devin Mesoraco never really has control of that baseball. And Lowry's able to sneak in there and put his hand on the plate. Meanwhile, the batter Moss goes to second. The trail runner Suspendes goes to third. And the A's are on an uprising again.
Second and third, nobody out. Three straight hits here in the bottom of the fourth. That's a single and an RBI for Moss. Here's a drive to left field by Donaldson. And the second game in a row is it a multi-home run, a multi-run homer. This one, a three-run shot. Cespedes, Moss in front of him. Four run fourth, 4-0 A's.
Now I guess with the way the A's play against National League teams, the Reds ought to be happy that they don't play in the National League. That looks like a slider or a cut fastball of some kind that just kind of hangs over middle in. It was Donaldson last night that hit a long home run on a first pitch curveball from Bronson Arroyo. That slider unjammed right there way back into left field. And four quick ones on the board before an out is recorded here in the fourth.
12th of the year for Donaldson. Now it's 51 runs batted in. Second consecutive game that Oakland has put a four spot up. Last night in the third. Now today here in the fourth. Frazier handles this hard ground ball. And Reddick is gone 5-3. And home run by Donaldson, a right-handed batter against the right-hander Bailey, ends a stretch of 138 and two-thirds innings. 138 and two-thirds innings since Bailey has given up a home run ball to a right-hander.
Well, his home runs are down overall this year. I mean, coming into this ball game, he'd only given up six all year long in 96 innings. So he's been very stingy with the home run ball, something that always plagued him. But oftentimes when you're pitching, it's not whether you hit your spots, it's where you miss your spots. And if you miss out over the middle of the dish, that's those are the balls that the other team hits home runs on.
The last right-hander prior to Donaldson here in this fourth inning to go deep against Bailey was Justin Maxwell of the Houston Astros back on the 7th of September last year. 21 starts ago for Bailey. Good long stretch. Well, Josh Donaldson, a guy who given the third base job last year due to the injury to Scott Sizemore, and he has seized the opportunity. Nine total home runs a year ago, already has a dozen this year. Reds have to play come from behind baseball here at O.co today. Set down by Bailey since the home run ball. A three run shot by Donaldson, the big blow here, and now ball four.
Boy, you get ahead of him 0-2. It looks like Homer Bailey all of a sudden got really riled out there after giving up the home runs and or the home run, and ended up getting Reddick out no problem, Steven Vogt out no problem. Goes 0-2 to the number 9 hitter in the lineup by blowing two fastballs right by him and then eventually walks him.
Don't forget tonight's Ohio Lottery Powerball jackpot worth $40 million. The drawing will be at 11 p.m. tonight. Ohio Lottery Powerball jackpot sitting at $40 million. So Brian Price used to team with Bob Melvin, the manager slash pitching coach, Arizona. Bob Melvin was let go there with the Diamondbacks. In 09, Ryan Price resigned out of loyalty to Bob. Their misfortune turned out to be the Reds' fortune as he then came over to the Reds, and he's been the pitching coach here now with Dusty Baker for the last, 4 years. Here's the eighth man to bat in the inning, Chris Young. Fan twice. And the Reds will have to put their hitting shoes on now. Down 4-0 here in the bottom of the fourth against a right-hander AJ Griffin, who's retired 8 in a row.
I'd really like to see more of that, which is fastballs from Homer Bailey. Today, Bailey has been beat on his off-speed pitches like he has many other times before. I mean, I don't think that there's but a handful of pitchers in all of Major League Baseball that wouldn't give anything to have Homer Bailey's fastball. Yet he's given up his double in this inning to Brandon Moss. I think he gave up the base hit by Cespedes on a splitter, and Josh Donaldson hit a slider for a home run. And here's a guy throwing 96 and 97 miles an hour getting beat on his secondary pitches. Use the stuff that got you here.
They'll throw to second and get the out. As a runner took off from first base, Eric Sogard, he's gone. And that ends the bottom of the fourth inning, but not before the Athletics put four on the board. Here's Bailey stepping off, spinning. Tag applied there by Cozart. Pardon me, by his Durant.
Oakland leads it 4-0 over the Reds as we get ready for the top of the fifth inning here. The Reds coming to bat, and Zach Cozart. Well, you know, this Oakland A's team's pretty quirky. Remember through the years, the elephant and the white shoes that all the team wore? Well, the craze last year, it was called the Bernie, okay? It was kind of generated from the film Weekend at Bernie's. Even the fans got into it here. And after great offensive plays, home runs, great defensive plays, the fans, the players, all did the Bernie. So, bobbleheads. Everybody wants a bobblehead. We all know that. But here, it's a little bit different. Saturday is Coco Crisp Bobblehead Day as Cozart flies out to right field. And instead of having the head bobble, the Coco Crisp Bobblehead bobbles at the waist as they lean back and Coco does the Bernie. And you know what, Chris Welsh? I saw Jim Kelch doing this twice on this road trip already. The Bernie.
You know, it could have been in the Starlight Room, pick at top of the Sir Francis Drake Hotel, where they've got the Bernie type music. Maybe you're up there celebrating with Coco Crisp all the great things that have happened in that family and with you over the last few days. And I'll tell you, it's catching on, Jim Kelch, and you're right in the center of it.
Well, I was doing the Bernie each time Pick said, hey, let's go to the Pinecrest Diner. I was excited. I said, all right, let's do the Bernie over there.
Every time he got his pancakes, Chris, he got up and did the Bernie.
That going to fall? No, yes, it does get down. Young dropped the ball. At least it hit the heel of his glove, it appeared. And Mesoraco is aboard.
Well, that's a ball looking back on it. If you can get to it, the old saying is you should be able to catch it. And the ball, as you said, Jim, you're exactly right. Hit off the heel of his glove. He kind of overran that ball. It would have been a nice catch, obviously. And they'll give Mesoraco a hit. That is the first hit of the day for the Reds.
And
a blooper drop by the center fielder.
Yeah. Nine in a row had been retired by Griffin. Young kept running after that. It looked like he thought there were three out. He had caught the ball. He was going to run on into the dugout. Let's see what his tourist can do now. He really muscled up on one his last time.
You know, Griffin, as we said, is 5-6 this year. Earned run average under 4. He makes his 31st career start this afternoon. And he's been in somewhat of a little bit of a slump, as you said at the very onset of the broadcast. His last 5 games, 0-3. The team has lost each one of those last 5 starts. But here's a young man that has postseason experience. He started game number 5 last year when the Oakland A's lost the first 2 games in Detroit. Then they came back here. They won game 3. They won game 4. They sent A.J. Griffin out in game 5. He pitched pretty well in that ball game, but they did not win.
Double play ball to short. Turned by the Athletics.
The division series, that is.
Lowry, Sogard, Moss turn the twin killing. The Reds finish here in the top of number 5. American Ballpark when the Reds begin a three-game series against the Seattle Mariners. That's on Friday, July the 5th. Then after the game, stick around for a post-game fireworks show featuring a soundtrack picked by Reds manager Dusty Baker and presented by PNC Bank. It's a weekend of baseball, fireworks, and giveaways July 5th through the 7th. Call 513-381-REDS or visit reds.com/July to purchase your tickets. Reds will be home on Monday, taking on the San Francisco Giants. Four games against the defending world champions. First time the two teams would have met. Minor spring training, since the Giants eliminated the Reds in the NLDS last year in five. Then that Seattle series. Then the Reds go out for seven. And after they finish up that seven-game road trip down goes Milwaukee, Atlanta. That will take the team to the Major League All-Star break. Today's the 79th game of the year, so the mathematical midpoint of the season will be after Saturday's game down at Texas. 81. Unofficial midway point is the All-Star break. Young was at the plate when Sogard tried to run quickly on Bailey from first, and Homer got him at second base. So Young back up there here to start inning number five. And as he did in the first and third, Chris Young is a strikeout victim here in the fifth.
Yeah, nice to see Homer Bailey using the fastball and moving it around the zone. I mean, it's one thing that you tell young pitchers in the minor leagues. They say, hey, young man, before you move along the system, you're going to have to be able to move the ball around in the zone and get outs with your fastball. And Homer Bailey's done that today. What unfortunately has happened, though, he's gotten beaten on his other stuff.
Seth Smith now.
Like an old scout once said, don't fall in love with the sugar. Eat your meat and potatoes, but don't fall in love with the sugar. And of course, in pitching, the meat and potatoes is your fastball.
An eating analogy, that's a good one.
I know you could relate to that.
Over the years, I would say I have fallen in love with the sugar.
You've been much better lately. I've been very impressed.
Have you?
Yeah.
Thanks. When you're around.
Of course, I was jumping on that apple pie right with you.
Yes.
And I'm not saying for Homer Bailey, all he has to do is rear back and throw fastballs every pitch. I mean, that's obviously not going to work. But you hate to see a guy get beat on a pitch that is not his best. Especially when they haven't centered his fastball up yet today. I mean, he's got it coming out of his hand pretty good. And you always hear that, well, some radar guns are faster than others. That's not the case. The way it has been explained to me, that all the radar gun readings that you see are originated by the MLB FX system. And there's an FX system in every ballpark. It is identical, so that, you know, one gun doesn't read 97 on the same fastball that another gun would read 92. The strike zones are very accurate. They are tailored for every hitter, at least height wise they are. Obviously, side to side, they stay the same, 17 inches. So when you're seeing 96, as you see right there, that's legit.
So it's a misnomer when you hear about slow guns and fast guns.
That may be the case in amateur baseball when you have a scout with a radar gun. That can't happen. But at Major League Baseball field, when they've got the FX system turned on, what you see on your screen is all generated by the same computer system. It's actually an algorithm. They've got cameras all over the ballpark and they shoot different parts of the baseball. That's how you can tell on the system, you know, what kind of pitch it is, how many revolutions it takes, how much it drops. And they can pretty much identify the type of pitch. And the radar guns at the scoreboard to get the same thing.
That one looked like it's in the dirt somewhere.
Well, they've got them all over. I'm not sure how many there are, and there was an algorithm written to be able to figure out all the nuts and bolts behind the speed and the velocity, or speed and spin and so on. I can tell you that was pretty quick. If you don't believe it, ask Seth Smith. Five of them in the ball game for Homer Bailey, and each of the last two have come via the fastball.
All five strikeouts have come from the top two spots. Three times Chris Young, twice Seth Smith. So two out. Here's Jed Lowry. Pair of hits in this game, both singles. Mentioned Lowry with two hits in this game now has 88 hits on the year. Already a career best for him. Last year he had 83 with Houston, his lone year down there. Year before that, 78 with Boston, a Red Sox high for him, part-time player. Getting much more playing time here, Lowry. Astros brought him in last year from Boston, thinking he was going to be an everyday guy for them. They gave up Mark Melancon, who went to Boston for Lowry. Melancon ineffective last year, but boy, has he been the guy in the eighth inning role for Pittsburgh this year. Melancon and Jason Grilley, an eight, ninth inning combo for the Pirates. Very, very good. February then of this year, Lowry was traded by the Astros to the Athletics. The five-player deal. Pirates are also playing today. That game started just at about the same time in which the Reds got going. They're playing up in Seattle, and in the bottom of the fourth up there, Pittsburgh leads 2-1. Strikeout there of Lowry, and Bailey strikes out the side here in the bottom of the fifth.
Head and shoulders now with a hint of Old Spice. Striking out the side is Homer Bailey. He went 1-2-3. Chris Young, Seth Smith. and Jed Lowry here on the top of the fifth inning. And most of those with a pretty good fastball are with the Bold Spice. And don't forget to use hashtag whiff at Reds in your tweets to help raise funds for the MLB's RBI program. Each month, the team with the most tweets will receive $10,000 for their local RBI program.
Haley has walked one, struck out six in this game, but Reds find themselves in the short end, trailing 4-0 through five. Trying to get something going against A.J. Griffin. Chew to right field. And Reddick makes the catch.
As I was talking about Griffin before the inning ended, that was a double play by Asturias. He started game five of that postseason game, the ALDS against the Detroit Tigers. That's when the A's lost their first two in Detroit. Then they brought the Detroit Tigers back here. They won their next two. They sent A.J. Griffin out in game five. He did not get a decision in that ball game, but he went five innings of two-run baseball. So he's postseason hardened. As it turned out, the A's ended up winning that ball game 5-4 before Justin Verlander shut him down in the deciding game 6-0.
Now, this is a guy who didn't make his big league debut until late June of last year against the Giants. Pitched for a little over a month in the big leagues last year, then went on the disabled list with a strained right shoulder. But was 7-1 with an ERA right near 3 with the A's last year.
Well, there's got to be some deception going on, because here's a guy that is not topping out, you know, within 5 or 6 miles an hour of the fastball that Homer Bailey's throwing. But he's keeping the Reds off balance. He's got a nice overhand curveball that he's just using sparingly, just enough to keep him off the fastball. He's got a nice changeup that he's thrown the left-handers. There's the curveball there and another pop-up.
Sogard will handle this one. Two out. Remember, every Wednesday night at 6, that's tonight, you can tune in after the game. Join us for a look back at the previous week of Reds action on Reds Weekly on tonight's show, following Reds Live post game. It's the ultimate fans fantasy, putting on a Reds uniform and taking the field. Plus, how did NASCAR driver Kevin Harvick do on the diamond when he visited recently at GABP? Reds Weekly, new episode every Wednesday at 6, brought to you by Safe Auto. Drive safe, spend less. Mono bats with two out. Had a base runner get to third in the first inning. A walk, a fielder's choice, a walk, and a double steal. Second and third with one out. Bruce struck out, Frazier struck out. Nothing since then past first base. In fact, only two base runners since that time. He walked in the first, flied out in the third. Bruce on deck. Reds down 4-0. Moss has it, feeds the pitcher Griffin. In the third, 1-2-3 inning of this game, turned in by the 25-year-old from El Cajon, California. inaugural Reds Ultimate Autograph Experience. Don't miss your chance to get up close and personal with the 2013 Reds and get a bat, baseball, or jersey signed. This is your chance to get their autographs yourself. Visit Reds.com/autograph. Find out how you can take part in the Ultimate Autograph Experience. That's Reds.com/autograph. Cespedes leading off here in the bottom of the sixth. Little four-batter stint in this game has given Oakland the lead in which they hold right now. Fourth inning, single by Lowry, single by Cespedes, RBI single by Moss, three-run homer by Donaldson. 4-0 Oakland lead. Big time fastball there, and Cespedes retired.
That's four in a row for Homer Bailey. He's a pretty good looking pitcher, and the Reds have a couple of minor leaguers that'll be going to the All-Star Futures game. That'll be at New York. Carlos Contreras, he's a 22-year-old right-handed pitcher with Bakersfield, pitching for Ken Griffey Sr. out there. He's 3-7 on the year, but he's got a very good earned run average, and I think a lot of Contreras. Of course, Billy Hamilton, one of the best prospects in all the minor leagues. He will go also as a Reds representative. Now, Hamilton will play for the American team. That'll be coached by Mookie Wilson, former Mets outfielder. And Contreras will play on the world team, and that'll be coached by another former Met, Edgardo Alfonso.
And that's on the Sunday before the Tuesday big league game.
July the 14th. And that is really the game in which MLB showcases its up-and-coming stars. So if you're on that roster, you're somebody that a lot of people around baseball feel like that you will be an impact player in the major leagues at some point. Now, the interesting thing about this year's Futures games is that they will allow the last, I think, four places to be voted on by the fans. So you can get on, I think, MILB.com or maybe even MLB.com and scroll around till you find the Futures game, and you'll see those players that are in the final running for those final slots, and you can vote on those. None, there are no Reds organizational players in the final slots available to be voted in.
So Billy Hamilton will be the only player on the American team.
And Carlos Contreras on the other. So congratulations to both those guys.
Yes,
Billy Hamilton, by the way, hitting .247. He has stolen 49 and been thrown out 9 times so far in his efforts down in Louisville for the bats.
First year AAA, he's done pretty well in terms of stolen bases.
Well, he got off to a really bad start batting average wise, and it's been kind of an uphill climb for him to get it back and going.
Now, congratulations to Jim Riggleman's team today. They played an early game today at home, won 7-6 over Charlotte. Billy Hamilton hit a home run, his fifth of the year. Jose Arredondo picked up a save, his second of the year. Louisville won 7-6 over Charlotte. Ball four issued to Moss, so he's on with one out. Second walk by Bailey.
Now, Tony Cingrani down the bullpen warming up. I'm not sure if he's just getting some throwing in down there Well, whether Dusty Baker may use him, of course, there's no such thing as a batter having to come up in an inning. Reds will lead the inning off. Next inning with Jay Bruce coming up. Homer Bailey right at the 105 pitching mark right now, so this will probably be his last inning if he's able to make it through this inning.
Reds hit into a double play earlier. They'd like to turn one right here. Donaldson has hit into a team high 8. Boy, he has been a man with the big lumber in this series.
Reddick is a left-hander. He's the next batter due.
And they have 3 straight lefties.
I imagine that Cingrani better be ready for him. Unless Bailey rolls up a ground ball double play ball right here.
That blast he hit in the 4th inning against Homer.
That was a slider, a 90 mile an hour slider right down there. He went to get it. He had a first pitch curveball off of Bronson Arroyo last night for a home run. Arroyo said after the ball game, "I can't believe the pitches that they were swinging at early in the count." He says, "They turned the tables of surprise on me."
He said it's always like a chess match with him, and he always feels like he's able, when he's going well, to make that first move to get ahead. And last night,
well, it is. And of course, you get those post-game comments before the pitcher can actually go back and look at video of the game. But I think as Arroyo would look back on his ball game last night, he'll see that his pitch location, more than anything else, was the problem.
Is Turris. There's one, and the ball is dropped in the exchange by Cozart. So they do not get the double play. They get the force out on Moss at second base.
Boy, that was a tailor-made DP double play ball right here, right in DP lane. Good feed by Turris. Plenty of time for Zach Cozart. He just can't get the baseball out of his glove. And that'll continue the inning. It does not look like Dusty Baker is going to make any move at all to go get Homer Bailey right here.
Reddick is single and grounded out. Cingrani appears ready. Bailey will face Reddick with a runner on and 2 out. Cozart handles this on the broken bat pop up. Reddick is gone, and so are the Athletics here in the bottom of the 6th inning. They still lead this game 4-0.
and the accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without the express written consent of the Cincinnati Reds.
Back to that AT&T trivia question we talked about earlier. Jay Bruce is one of three major leaguers this year with at least 20 doubles, 15 homers, and 50 RBIs. Who are the other two? There they are, Baltimore Orioles both. Chris Davis and Adam Jones. Look at that, 28 home runs for Chili Davis, or Chris Davis, pardon me. 72 runs batted in, all that before the All-Star break. Big time numbers right there. Bruce trying to get on base. Well, only the second time in this series. And the first time via hit, he walked with the bases loaded yesterday. Reds have not been able to solve A.J. Griffin at all here this afternoon, to the tune of just one hit by Mesoraco. And a ball that should have been caught in center by Young, long run, but it hit the heel of his glove. Mesoraco was credited with a hit. The Reds have been given two walks in the first, and an error by Josh Donaldson at third for Oakland in the second. Griffin has been in control of this one throughout. Jay Bruce strikes out for the third time here this afternoon. Just as a reminder, get ready for Reds action 30 minutes before every game with Reds Live pregame brought to you by Ray St. Clair Roofing. Reds baseball, of course, right here on Fox Sports Ohio, your exclusive home of the Reds. Five strikeouts by Griffin, three of them Jay Bruce today.
Yeah, I think what's happened with Jay Bruce is that the A's have figured out that it's easier to change speeds on Jay Bruce than trying to work the ball around the strike zone to get the guy out with pitches in the same speed range. AJ Griffin really has used that breaking ball right there, that big over the top 12 o'clock to 6 o'clock curve, to kind of set up the fastball. You see that pitch coming in there at 80 miles an hour. Next thing you know, here comes an 88 to 90 mile an hour fastball, and you pop it up. And that's what happened right there with Todd Frazier. Or if you're Jay Bruce, you swing through it. I mean, the guy's moving his fastball around, and he's not staying in the middle of the zone with it, but he's setting that pitch up with the other pitches rather than the other way around.
Well, he's set down six in a row since the base hit by Mesoraco.
Xavier Ball.
And 15 of the last 16 since the error allowed Cozart to reach back in the second inning. Here's Xavier Paul, 0 for 2 in this game now, 1 for his last 19. High and deep to right and up against the wall in the ballpark. In the second base is Paul. He has himself a double. That's that 15-foot wall out there, so it did not come close to going out. Reddick thought he could catch it. Paul has himself a two-base hit.
Well, Reddick's going to take a look at the scoreboard video here at the ballpark, and we're going to take another look at it with a whole better angle. Xavier Paul thinks he's got it. Reddick is a good defender now. I mean, he's got a good arm. He's good pursuit. I think he just may have misjudged where that ball was going. Maybe lost sight of it the last second, as he looked like it went a little bit to his left, but he's looking into the sun right there. Normally a really good defender is Reddick.
Only the second Reds hit. First extra base hit. It comes with two out. First runner to get further than first base since the first inning for the Reds. If the Reds can capitalize and get on the scoreboard here in the seventh, down 4-0. Cozart reached on an error in the second, flied out in the fifth against A.J. Griffin. Talked earlier about the fact he has not won a game since May the 25th down in Houston. hasn't won a home game since May the 13th. Only had one quality start in his last six outings. All that by the wayside so far here today. Strikes out number six for A.J. Griffin, and the Reds strand Paul out at second base. Stretch time here in Oakland. San Francisco Giants in a four-game series. It starts on Monday, July the 1st, and presented by Mentos. Plus, don't miss a post-game fireworks show and Todd Frazier bobblehead giveaway on Wednesday, July the 3rd. For tickets to this exciting matchup and a week of fireworks and giveaways, easy to call, just 513-381-REDS, or you can visit reds.com/July. Reds and the Giants. For the first time since the playoffs last year.
Well, the Giants are certainly not playing like a World Series winner this year. They're in fourth place in the National League West. Right now they're one game under 500. They trail Arizona only by 3.5 games, though. That's how competitive that particular division is. In fact, the Dodgers are the last place team. Eight games under 500, but yet only seven games back in the standings. Tony Cingrani, he'll pick up for Homer Bailey, who went six innings of four-run, seven-strikeout baseball. I'm not so sure that this is the way they envisioned using Tony Cingrani as more of a, I can't say mop-up because it's only 4-0. But certainly wanted to use him in some pressure-packed situations, but they need to get him into a ballgame. He's not been into a ballgame since the Reds hosted Pittsburgh on June the 20th.
So after making seven starts for the Reds, this is a relief appearance number four for Tony Cingrani. We get Stephen Vogt, the catcher, who's 0-for-2, to lead it off, and he's quickly in the hole. Then Sogard, then Young, representing the top of the order. Yeah, unfortunately for Cingrani, the last time we saw him pitch was in that Thursday afternoon game at home. He came on. Was able to get Garrett Jones on strikes, but Pedro Alvarez, with the bases loaded, one out, doubled into the right field corner, scoring three, breaking a 2-2 tie, Pirates went on to win that game 5-3. Come back into the mound, and Cingrani handles that with ease. And Vogt is 0-3. We talked a lot about the fact that it's not been as difficult, or so it appears, for Cingrani to make the adjustment to a reliever simply because he filled that role for so long in college.
Well, you're right about that. He was a closer at Rice University, for those that have not followed the early part of Tony Cingrani's career. Raised in Chicago, went down to Rice after a stint, I believe, in a junior college. And they converted him to a reliever down there. In his first year with Rice, he pitched so awful that he went to the coaching staff after the season was over and said, you know, I'm so terrible, do you even want me back next year? And they reassured him, yes, we want you back. And they made a couple of adjustments to his delivery where it kind of shortened up his arm action a little bit. And his fastball suddenly went from about 84 miles an hour to 94 miles an hour. That and, of course, the natural maturation process of being a teenager into a young man in his early 20s. And now he sits around 93 to 94 miles an hour with that fastball. He, as a starter for the Reds and even in the minor leagues, would rely on that pitch about 80% of the time. So he's really a fastball pitcher first. He's still trying to get a good feel of his off-speed pitches. He's always had a better changeup than slider, but they're working on the slider now.
Taken nicely out into left field there. He's going to take two as Sogard. Robinson way deep out there, cut that ball off. Sogard with a good read on it. He gets himself a double.
Well, Sogard was, it looked like to me, he was content for a single right here. He wasn't thinking about double out of the box. I mean, he's kind of jogging to first base, thinking there's a base hit. Derek Robinson's going to cut it off and get it back in here. But the combination of Robinson surrounding that ball, I mean, that's not the kind of sprinting you do to first base when you're thinking double. That was all because Robinson circled the ball around, didn't play it aggressively, and then eventually slipped to let him get into second base. Are they giving him a double?
We'll check to be sure, but I would believe that they are. It is indeed the 11th double of the year. Top of the order now, and Young. Seventh hit by the Athletics, their second extra base hit. Young glad to see a pitching change. He struck out three times against Bailey. This 29-year-old out of Houston finds himself in the hole 1-2. We talked about some of the big years he had. He had a 32 home run year, his fourth in rookie of the year voting in the National League back in 2007. Drove in 85 runs the following year, 27 homers, 91 RBIs. Back in 2010, 2 years ago, 20 homers, 71 runs batted in. Last year's numbers fell off. This year he finds himself as a part-time player at 29 here in Oakland. 139 career home runs. And he strikes out for the fourth time in this game. Take a look at our Miller Time moment of the game, brought to you by Miller Lite and involving the starter Tony Cingrani. This is way back on April the 28th in D.C. Tony Cingrani. Strikeout there of Harper. Strikeout of Desmond. Strikeout of Adam LaRoche. Count of 1, 2, 3, 4. Four strikeouts in the game due to a wild pitch on that strikeout of Gernard Spann. Tied, of course, a franchise record. Four strikeouts in that fourth inning back on April the 28th. Our Miller Time moment of the game.
You know, Tony Cingrani impressed a lot of people in spring training, and but you always kind of have a tendency to write what happens in March off a little bit too. Well, it's not big league, guys aren't grinding it out, and so on. But when he did what he did in Washington, I'm not just not talking about the four strikeout, but the way he pitched against the Nationals, a very highly regarded ball club, that opened a lot of eyes about Tony Cingrani.
That was the day that he struck out 11.
Yeah.
Of no runs, two hits in six innings in a 5-2 Reds win where they were on the verge of being swept in that series. That was when people had high hopes for the Nationals. They're still a 500 club, but boy, they have struggled a lot. They've gone through a lot from an injury standpoint. Now Nate Freeman is batting for Seth Smith. First we've seen a Freeman in this series. Hitting 270 with a couple of home runs, 16 RBIs. Guard out at second with two out. Freeman, a product of Duke, made his big league debut earlier this year. Lines this ball to the alley in left center. That will go to the wall. That will add to the Oakland lead. It's 5-0. Freeman comes up with a pinch hit double. He had been 1-for-9 as a pinch hitter this year. He comes through with a big one there against Cingrani.
Yeah, one thing the Oakland A's are not afraid of doing is that they will substitute right-handers for left-handers and so on based on the opposing pitcher. Freeman comes into this ballgame hitting over 320 against lefties. I mean, he is a platoon-type hitter. And he levels a low fastball into the gap, and that's another run batted in.
Brian Price back to the mound.
Last night, the bullpen did a great job for Dusty Baker's crew in relief for Bronson Arroyo. It was the hitting that didn't come around. Right now, Cingrani's given up a run here in his first inning. Looks like Alfredo Simon down warming up in the bullpen. But in the meantime, Dusty Baker's got to give a talking to his hitters. They've got but six outs left, and they've only collected two hits all day long against the starter, A.J. Griffin. There's Simon.
Bailey threw 111 pitches in six innings. Cingrani relieving him here in the seventh. Been touched up for a run on two hits, pair of doubles. It's been a dominating two games by the Athletics against the Reds. 7-3 last night, 5-0 so far here today. Lowry is two out of three, scored a run. Lowry turns around, bats on the right side. better side is his left side, hitting .315 batting left, .280 batting right. All of his home runs come from the left side, four of them. He's trying to move the pinch hitter Freeman around. Batting for Smith, doubled in a run. Bullpen has been quiet on the Oakland side of things. Griffin has thrown only 87 pitches through seven innings. That's a strikeout of Lowry. Two of them in the inning for Cingrani, but another Oakland run across the board. And all A.J. Griffin from a pitching standpoint has given up just two hits to the Reds. Walked two in the first inning. That didn't do him any harm. And he struck out six. Only 87 pitches through seven. Meanwhile, from an offensive standpoint, Brandon Moss, an RBI single in the fourth inning, made it 1-0. Last night's offensive hero, Josh Donaldson, made that play at the plate. Donaldson, a big blow again today. Last night a two-run homer, today a three-run homer. And it is 5-0 Athletics through seven. Our Honda game summary. Back to work, A.J. Griffin. Mesoraco leads it off here in the eighth. Is Turris and Chu to follow. My apologies, by the way, to Nate Freeman. I called him Nate Freeman. It's Nate Freeman. With a pop foul, and Mesoraco is out. So Griffin just keeps motoring along. He's gone eight inning one time this year. That was in his second start of the season against the Angels on April the 11th. Trying to get through eight here this afternoon. He's at 90 right now. Now at 91 as he gets the second out of the eighth, as his Turris rolls out easily 4-3.
Well, he's rolling through this Reds lineup so efficiently and so quickly, you think he's got an appointment for a haircut coming up this afternoon, but that is not the case. A.J. Griffin has not cut his hair since spring training of 2012.
So he went all winter with that look as he was walking the beaches of
And also, I was talking to Ray Fosse, the color analyst for the A's, and of course, the former Oakland A catcher, great one, about Griffin. He telling me that those glasses he wears really doesn't need them. He wears them so the hitter doesn't see his eyes. Not sure what that means, but quarterbacks do that so that they can't, you know, you check off receivers and so on. But whatever he's got going today, it's working for him.
Trying to even his record at 6-6 if he can post the victory here this afternoon. He's made quick work of the Reds. And a chance in the first and a chance in the seventh, a double with two out.
Well, in addition to the six strikeouts that he has this afternoon, he has induced four pop flies in the infield, including one, I think, in foul territory. You don't see really that many pop-ups in the infield in a ball game like that. .67 miles an hour on that slow breaking curveball. Boy, really gets some arm speed through that. In fact, that baby was coming straight down by the time it got to the plate.
Sogard handles that ground ball. Fourth time today, the Reds go in order. The offense dormant here this afternoon at O.co. With the O.co Coliseum in Oakland, California. Final game of this series. Oakland leading 5-0. Reds bring on their third pitcher of the day. That will be Alfredo Simon to take over for Tony Cingrani.
Cingrani went one inning, gave up a run on a couple of doubles.
Yoenis Cespedes leads off here in the bottom of the eighth. He's 1-for-3. One hit in each of the two games of this series. He was aboard on the Josh Donaldson home run back in that four-run fourth. Reds will have one last crack at A.J. Griffin. Way up there by Cespedes. And it's caught by Robinson.
Well, how about a Mazda pitch by pitch with the brand new pitcher Alfredo Simon coming into the ball game to start the eighth inning. Wants obviously to get that first pitch breaking ball over. Does not. But here comes the fastball and it's popped straight up in the air by the former Cuban national player. And Simon has a fly ball to left for the first out of the inning. That is our Mazda pitch by pitch.
Here's Brandon Moss. Offers at the first one, doesn't get it. Misses that one as well.
Well,
They stay right here. Have the Cardinals coming in over the weekend. Friday night, Saturday afternoon, Sunday afternoon. Three pitches and Simon disposes of Moss, so two out. 10 strikeouts now for Reds pitching. And they have the Cubs in, so this is a nice long homestand for the Athletics. Here is Josh Donaldson. Big, big series for him. Two-run homer yesterday, three-runner today. So five RBIs in this series. A Nissan drive of the game back in the fourth inning against Homer Bailey. He went down to get that. Hit it into the seats out beyond the left center field wall above the out-of-town scoreboard. 12th of the year, 51 RBIs. That's tops on this Athletics team. That made it 4-0 at the time. It's 5-0 A's now. They bat here in the bottom of the eighth. Simon familiar with this ballpark, having pitched in the American League for years with the Baltimore Orioles. Reds in the ninth inning will have Robinson, Votto, and Bruce. Not seen an appearance out here in this series of the former Oakland A, Jack Hanahan, for the Reds. He was greeted heartily when we entered the ballpark today by one of the security guards down below that befriended Jack when he played back here in 07, 08, part of 09. Best home run year here was 2008. Jack Hanahan, when he had 9 home runs, drove in a career best 47 that year as an everyday, primarily third baseman for Oakland that year. Donaldson draws a 2-out walk. Don't forget, after the game, stay with us here in Fox Sports Ohio. We'll break it down with the Reds Live post-game show brought to you by Kings Honda and the Kings Auto Mall. We invite you to visit KingsHondaUSA.com. Jeff Pecora will head up our post-game coverage immediately following today's game. Then after that, Reds Live, rather Reds Weekly. Reds Live after the game, Reds Weekly following that. Roddick is 1-for-3. Ball bounced away from Mesoraco on that swing of the miss by Reddick. Down to second base goes Donaldson. Pitch, by the way, charged to Simon. This should put an end to the bottom of the eighth as Cozart stays with that high pop up. Josh Reddick retired. And the inning is over, and that sets the stage now for the Reds coming up in the ninth inning, trailing 5-0. Memory lane. There's Joe Morgan wearing the Oakland Athletics uniform, June 24th, 1984. That home run, 265th as a second baseman for Joe Morgan in his career. At the time, that was an all-time record for home runs by a second baseman. Joe Morgan Way right outside the ballpark here leading up to O.co Coliseum. That record has since been broken, but he still has a lot of fans out here. Joe himself is here for this two-game series. Played here near the end of his career, Joe Morgan. Jeff Kent has since surpassed him for home runs by a second baseman, but certainly one of the best, Joe Morgan, Hall of Famer. Great to see him around the ballpark all the time. 84 was his last year, in fact, as a major leaguer. Meanwhile, A.J. Griffin is going for his first ever complete game shutout. Longest outing this year, 8. This will be his 100th pitch. Robinson will roll that thing to the right side, and Sogard will throw him out. Route number one. Reds have the day off tomorrow, then head to Texas. Here's what the pitching matchup looks like down there. Johnny Cueto roughed up in Arizona, back on the mound on Friday against Martin Perez. Then on Saturday, Mike Leake against Nick Tepich. And Sunday, in the 3:05 Eastern time start, Matt Latos goes for number 8 against Yu Darvish. That's a matchup of 7 game winners right there. Friday's game, Sunday's game on Fox Ohio, Saturday's game, Fox Network. Otto 0-for-2 with a walk. Reds have been shut out 4 times this year. Oakland is gunning for its 6th shutout win of the year. Off the pitcher's glove to the shortstop. Lowry over the first in time. That'll go down as a 1-6-3. I guess this is called a lean time right now, Chris Welch, for the Reds.
Well, you're right about that, Jim. It reminds me of several years ago. I want to say it was back in 2007 when the Reds came through here and they were just completely dominated by the Mark Mulder-led Oakland A's, and it has not got any better here. They get shut out here today on 2 hits, one of them a blue single, And it just doesn't look like a ball club that's doing much at all offensively. They had plenty of opportunities last night. They have no opportunities today. And they've just been beaten by a ball club that's playing better baseball right now. Even though coming into this ball game, the A's were on somewhat of a losing skid. So Dusty Baker, after a day off in Texas tomorrow, is going to have to get his troops together and give them a little pep talk because they look a little flat.
And the Cardinals play tonight down in Houston. The Reds fail to come back here, and the Cardinals win tonight. The Reds will be 4.5 out. That will be their largest deficit of the year. The Pirate game is 2-2 in the eighth up in Seattle. Who strikes out for the fourth time? And A.J. Griffin here on June the 26th, 2013, records his first ever complete game. It's a shutout, and Oakland wins it by the final of 5-0. That was dominance by the young right hand.
It certainly was. He showed a good curveball, good command, a guy that struggled to get his sixth win of the year. He's now evened his record at 6-6. He did it in quick time, too. Ball game today only took 2 hours and 20 minutes to play. 45 minutes or an hour from now, the Reds will be on a bus headed to the airport, and I'm sure they'll be happy to get out of the Bay Area and on their way to Texas.
5-0 the final. Oakland a winner. We'll be back with more after this.